Surely we're going to finish my favorite 2023 books before the end of this year, right? Hey, what's going on, everybody? Justin here, and in this video, I'm going to share my top three plus an honorable mention of my favorite medieval history reads that I read last year. I don't think any of these were published. Actually, one was published in 2023, and I think the others were actually all pretty fairly recently in the last like 5 or 6 years or so. But yeah, let's just go ahead and get started. I feel like I ramble on quite a bit recently, so let's just get into it. First up, we're going to start with the honorable mention, and what's kind of funny with this list is I have one physical book, one audiobook, one like ebook, and one library book. So I thought that was kind of just a weird, like, I was going to say trifecta, but I guess it'd be like quadfecta or something. But let's just get started here. For the honorable mention, we got a social history. We got Chaucer's People, Everyday Lives in Medieval England by Lisa Picard. I really enjoy social histories, and this one very much reminded me of Joseph and Francis Guy's like Life in a Medieval City. The author takes, kind of as like a starting point, all the different pilgrims that are found in the Canterbury Tales written by Chaucer, and kind of going through their different like lives and occupations, and kind of like a general attitude of what that would be. Just for example, like for the cook, we kind of learn all about how were kitchens set up in medieval England, you know, what ingredients and spices are they actually using, kind of what tools they are, what does the kitchen actually look like, what kind of meals are they making, all that kind of stuff. So if you enjoy social histories like I do, I just feel like the medieval side of things just does so good with the social histories for some reason. I've read some Greco-Roman ones as well, and they don't seem to measure up to the medieval ones. I don't know if it's just we got better source material, maybe some better archaeological stuff kind of going on, so we can kind of put things in context a little bit better. But I just found it really engaging. I thought the writing was great, and like I said, just really good. Felt like I learned a lot. Like I said, all a bunch of different trades and occupations and lifestyles are taken into account. So just really enjoyable, and you should check it out if that sounds good to you. Alright, next up, we have a military history, which is kind of strange for me. I don't read a whole lot of, like, just, like, battle books. It's like, I don't know what I was getting at with there, just, like, kind of straight-up military campaign-type books. But this one is Crecy, Battle of Five Kings by Michael Livingston. And he actually just came out with Agincourt, I think, at the end of last year as well. But this is all about Crecy. You know, it's one of the first... major battles of the Hundred Years' War in 1346, you know, about a decade or so after the Hundred Years' War breaks out. And it is a pretty notable battle. That's kind of why I picked it up in the first place. I felt like I should just, like, know more about it. It's one of the ones, you know, the English kind of always bring up, we were outnumbered so heavily by the French and this and that. I found it pretty engaging. The big shtick the author was trying to drive in this title was that the I guess traditional location of the Battle of Crecy he thinks is incorrect, and he was kind of putting out all the evidence of why he thinks it was in this other place. I've never been there, and I didn't really know that much about like the actual location stuff, so I don't really have like an axe to grind, so I wasn't really swayed either way, just because I haven't read enough on, like, you know, the traditional academic, I guess academic traditional site either. But it does do a good job. The book does a great job of setting up the context, setting the scene of the battle, also kind of dealing in not just like the tactics and strategy of the battle itself, but a lot of kind of like the logistical stuff that, you know, is kind of going on with like transportation, supplies, all that kind of thing leading up to the battle. So I felt that was really good. Sometimes that kind of logistical stuff gets left out. And I learned, the Black Prince is a major figure. This is kind of the battle where I think he's 16 or 17 when the battle takes place, and his father, the king, lets him just kind of like claim the victory and stuff. And that's kind of like the beginning of his sort of like, you know, famous military career for those who study medieval history and whatnot. But there was one character I need to start reading more about, and it's King John of Bohemia, who dies at the Battle of Crecy. But he just, he was brought up in the book, and just really, really cool. I got a quote I wrote down when I was reading about him and stuff. But King John of Bohemia became blind as an adult, but he still like campaigned and did stuff. And during the Battle of Crecy, you know, he was kind of being told by some of his retinue and stuff, you know, the battle's lost and this and that. And, you know, it might not be word for word what he said, but what's kind of come down to us is like one of his like kind of last like little speeches, I guess speeches, it's not really a speech per se, but one of his last lines has come down to us. I can't remember, was it John of Foissant or whatever, I think, who chronicled the battle, like, I think within like a decade or so. Anyways, he said, "Far be it the king of Bohemia should run away. Instead, take me to the place where the noise of battle is loudest. The Lord will be with us. Nothing to fear. Just take good care of my son." And then his retinue, they all tied their horses together so they couldn't, like, get separated because, you know, King John is literally blind. And then they kind of go into the fray and they're all cut down eventually, like, you know, in the aftermath of battle. And there is kind of like a legend of the Black Prince finding out about this in the aftermath and whatnot. And taking on the heraldry of King John of Bohemia, which was like ostrich feathers. And his motto, which was Ich Dien, which is I serve, in like Middle German or something. There is a little bit of kind of muddy ground on whether that's accurate or not, because there might have already been ostrich feathers in use, and King John didn't always use ostrich feathers and this and that. But I just found it was just a really cool legend and stuff, so I gotta read more about King John and Bohemia. But anyways, if you like medieval battles, if you like, I guess, military history in general, I think Crazy might be a book for you for sure. Next up we have The Word Hoard, Daily Life in Old English by Hannah Vadim. And this one is one of the 2020, this was a 2020, I lied. I don't know if this was a 2023 release. I keep saying it is. It might not. Nope. 2021 and, well, 2022. Anyways, this is a word hoard of Old English, which a word hoard actually was like a phrase that they kind of used as just like a, almost like a dictionary kind of collection of words that people would use and stuff and practice with. What this book does is each chapter kind of has a theme, whether that's like, you know, like occupations and lifestyles. There's some more like abstract ones, like religion, things like that, and breaking down different words that have come down to us that they've kind of combed through the manuscripts and things that, you know, have contained words in the archaeology and all that kind of stuff. And kind of just learning about the etymology of the words, because some words, like the word word, is like Old English and really hasn't like changed like a whole lot, but then there's tons of words that have. One of the things I found really interesting is actually a lot of the words where there's only one usage, like in all the manuscripts and stuff that's come down to us, there's only one instance of it, and that makes it really difficult to actually, especially if it's in like a weird context or weird setting, like in the story or with a phrase or the poem or whatever, where the word is from, it can make for a lot of debate. And I remember one was just so crazy. Right here, we got paradise is called, and I'm probably butchering the word, paradise is called New York's Nawang in Old English. The Wang element means plain or field, but no one knows what New York's Na means. Although there is no shortage of theories, Gunnbrad Vigvesen, one of the foremost Scandinavian scholars of the 19th century, thought New York's Nawang meant Garden of the Norns, the three, you know, the three goddesses of fate or destiny in Norse mythology. And then she kind of goes over a bunch of other scholars who think that's total nonsense and stuff. But I just find that stuff really fun. She's also released another one. Oh, I wrote it down. It's a bestiary, so it's all about like the flora and fauna and stuff. Oh, I'm pretty sure I wrote it down. Oh yeah, the Dior Horde. So it's going to be in the exact same style, I assume. But yeah, just really cool, and I definitely need to pick that one up. Just, you learn a lot of, like, kind of, just daily living, too. Like I said, kind of with, like, the occupations and, you know, names for different objects that people are using. And, you know, sometimes words that are used frequently because it's, you know, it's so ubiquitous, if that makes sense. So you've got like a really good context of like how people were using it and stuff. So I just found it really, really interesting. And like I said, if you like etymology or anything like that, I'm sure there are people, English professors that like grammar and stuff. But like I said, I really enjoy etymology. And if you do as well, I think you'll like this one. All right, so that leaves my number one favorite. And if you've been following the channel for any length of time during my comeback here, you'll probably guess which one it is, because I mentioned it several times so far, and it is Matilda, and it's, what is it, I was going to say Queen, Empress, Warrior, but it's Empress, Warrior, Queen. I lied. Empress, queen, warrior. I mean, that's try to make that dramatic and just totally butchered it. But anyways, this is by Catherine Hanley, and this is all about Empress Matilda, who is now like in my top three, I'd say, a favorite medieval historical figures. Just a really, really awesome, like, life story. So to give the gist of it, she is a granddaughter of William the Conqueror, William of Normandy. When her father, one of her brothers, William Adelin, dies in the White Ship disaster, which I think is 1120 off the top of my head, I think. Eventually, when Henry's kind of like starting to get old, King Henry's getting a little bit older and stuff, he realizes, you know, I might not have an heir. Makes all his, you know, court swear allegiance to Matilda as, you know, she's gonna be my successor if I don't have a son and stuff. And they all, like, agree to it. And everyone's kind of, like, hoping, you know, like, you know, hopefully he gets a boy here pretty soon. Anyways, she gets married off into the Holy Roman Emperor, which makes her Empress of the Holy Roman Empire. She also becomes Queen Consort of the Italians and stuff in her own right. And she does, like, a great job administrating all that kind of thing. And eventually, you know, the King of England does die, and Matilda is theoretically supposed to be the heir there, but she's, of course, in continental Europe. I think it's cousin Stephen of Blois just, like, takes hold of the treasure, like, instantly, and apparently, after some medieval reading over the past couple of years, that's pretty much the key to becoming the king or queen of England, is like owning the treasury. So he, you know, just swiftly just takes that and becomes king of England. And then she's like, no, that ain't right. And tries to launch a civil war, essentially known as the anarchy in England, over the throne. She eventually loses that kind of rebellion. Does last for several years, but it's kind of cool just like learning about how involved she was in the whole, you know, the whole, I guess, like, day-to-day activities of it. Her brother, or half-brother, I should say, who was a illegitimate son of her father's, was like her biggest supporter in England and stuff, like, kind of helping her, like, wage the campaigns and everything. But I just found it really interesting. Her life story is just really cool. If you like powerful women, read it. If you like medieval history, you need to read it. If you like powerful women in medieval history, you need to read it. So, I learned a lot. I think I had first read about her, like, kind of anecdotally in a couple medieval history books the year before, and I was like, I gotta find a book. And a couple of you had mentioned this one in the comments, so I'm really, really pleased you guys did, because this is just a really, and it's really well written, and just, like I said, it's an awesome medieval history, and you just learn a ton. She's just a really cool figure, and even though she doesn't, you know, win the crown for herself, one of her children does become the King of England, so it wasn't all for naught, but yeah, just a really cool, really cool, like, life story, and I feel like it's just not told enough about. I feel weird, like, when there's such a big thing like that, and I didn't know about it forever and ever and ever, even with all the other medieval histories I had read. It was just kind of, like, briefly mentioned in passing, like, during, like, the anarchy or whatever. But anyways, if you made it this far into the video, thank you so much. I hope you enjoy these medieval history recommendations. Let me know if any of these four books sound good to you, and if you're going to be picking them up at some point. If you want to support the channel, definitely check out my Etsy shop, where I got stuff kind of like that and whatnot. You know, like, follow, subscribe, all that kind of random stuff. But always remember, whether you're reading medieval history books or not, read victoriously.